Our first talk for this session will be given by Shelley Reisman Payne and John Zarin, and the title is The Exhibition Process at the Field Museum, A Collaborative Process Worth Considering. Shelley Reisman Payne, MSFAIC. Shelley received her degree in 1977 from the University of Delaware Winterthur program. She is the exhibitions conservator at the Field Museum Chicago and focuses on the care of objects and specimens on exhibition or tour. She has a special interest in preventive conservation and the care of collections and institutions undergoing change such as renovations or reinstallations, as well as the treatment of objects and sculpture. She has lectured and published on a variety of topics, and most recently the technical analysis of a medieval portable altar. And John Zarin was with the Field Museum for 18 years, 15 of which he ran the production shop for the exhibitions department, trained crews, assisted design, and built exhibitions. Excellent at problem solving and reducing costs, he has worked on such diverse projects as developing a system to move dinosaurs, building an enclosure for a Tiffany window, a 40 by 15 foot plywood and polycarbonate freestanding modular display structure, reworking design dinosaur mounts, building furniture, and even making a full-size biomechanics model that was filmed for the History Channel. A particular note was his work to develop cost-effective, high-performance display cases that have no internal wood products. John has a bachelor in arts, specializing in sculpture with earlier studies in math and physics. He maintains a career as a sculptor, showing art several times a year, and since leaving the Field Museum, works as an independent conservation fabrication consultant and as a CNC technician for ShopBot Tools, where he is exposed to a wide range of digital fabrication, both private and educational. So, I'd like to invite the two speakers up.
Good afternoon. John and I are really pleased to be here to discuss the exhibition process at the Field Museum. Originally initiated by Michael Spock, son of the famous Dr. Spock, over the past 2.5 decades, the exhibition process, now formalized in a document, is used by all who participate in the creation of an exhibition. Today, John and I will focus on how it facilitates collaboration to create beautiful, meaningful, and safe display environments for objects and specimens, while still satisfying the needs of conservation, production, development, and design. We'll use two examples throughout our presentation. We will show how old cases were retrofitted for the Bunky Echo Hawk Modern Warrior exhibition, and we will show how new cases were built for the recently opened 7,000 square foot Cyrus Tang Hall of China. The department is organized under the supervision of the Director of Exhibitions. The department is then subdivided in 4 areas, each overseen by a director. There's a Director of Exhibition Planning and Operations, Production, Development, and Design. In very broad strokes, exhibition planning and operation oversees securing, caring for, and touring the exhibition. Production sees to the installation and fabrication of all parts of the exhibition. Design oversees 2- and 3-dimensional design and produces all the needed drawings and layouts for the team. And finally, development produces the content for the exhibition. For those not familiar with developers, they're the staff that research and develop the stories to be told in the exhibition, working with curators and other content specialists as their advisors. Project managers work for the Director of Exhibition Planning and Operation, and they coordinate the efforts of the team. The team meets weekly and always includes a project manager, conservator, registrar, developer, 2-dimensional designer, 3-dimensional designer, production, mount shop, and media supervisors, and other key staff, depending on the scope of the project. The goal of the exhibition process is to produce an exhibition on budget that creates wonder for the visitor and provide safety for the objects and specimens on display. To accomplish this, the exhibition process is organized in five phases that is updated regularly. Each phase is designed to deliver specific milestones for the team and reviews by the directors. The point of the process is to provide a means for collaboration, to organize the exhibition workflow to allow everyone time for their work. This process is supported by two other resources, the exhibition guidelines and the materials database. The guidelines is a document that outlines safe approaches for design and production. The materials database is a shared database that stores the results of Oddy tests used to select materials for the exhibition. This Gantt chart illustrates the current working exhibition process. Let's go through it. Phase one is the proposal. The proposal includes a summary of the exhibit, market analysis, budget, dates, and a sketch of the exhibition space that is presented to the museum's executive team. If the executive team approves the proposal and fully funds it, then the exhibit is launched and the exhibition process continues. During this phase, each director contacts their staff to see if there are any significant issues that would need to be addressed if the museum were to either borrow or create this exhibition. This early review has allowed conservation and production to bring up a variety of issues related to fabrication and display. For example, the museum wished to present an exhibition about Haitian vodou. During phase one, conservation noted that for cultural reasons, the lenders said that the 540 objects in the exhibit could not be shown in display cases, and that any dust accumulation could not be removed. Open exhibition at the museum is just not customary, and dust had been a problem at the museum in the past. This caused conservation to test the dust and to advise on any actions needed prior to the exhibition. Ultimately, over a two-year period, the museum funded the complete cleaning of the exhibition hall, ductwork, and rebalancing of the HVAC system in preparation for this exhibition. By the way, I've tested dust throughout the museum for the past 4 years. I even included a sample from my own house. And it consistently is 90% cotton and 10% everything else. Phase two. This is called concept development, and it's a time when the content of the exhibit is completely fleshed out. This phase includes the developer's brief that outlines the overarching goals and research related to the content and objects that will be used in the exhibition. This phase can take years to develop or just months, depending on the scope of the exhibition. The deliverables include a bubble plan, this one for China Hall, and two forums that discuss content and ultimately the object scope. As the developers consider how objects will be incorporated into the exhibit, conservation performs its first assessment. This is done to point out any special issues related to the individual objects under consideration. Phase three is a time when the scope of work is written and ultimately defines the work of each team member. This phase covers the full spectrum of the exhibition from the draft object list to the final layouts and design prior to production. During this phase, there are three formal reviews by the director. The project direction is first. It is a time when the team demonstrates how the design meets the goals outlined in the scope of work. Reality check one is the first budget check for the project, and we must remember that the budget has already been established during the proposal. The preview is a more advanced presentation of the exhibition with 80% of the design complete and an illustration of how it will look and feel to the visitor. The review is the presentation of the final design and layouts for the exhibition. As the team enters phase three, a shared database is launched to populate information related to each object. For many years, the department used FileMaker. At this time, KEEMU, the museum database, is replacing FileMaker. However, the process to migrate to KE has been slow, so today I'll use the FileMaker database to simply illustrate the process. This is the Developers tab and includes information related to each object's content and research. This is the Conservation tab. The conservator enters information related to the condition of the object and special environmental needs, such as temperature, relative humidity, light levels for each object. It also includes whether a microclimate generator, silica gel, or a pest port is needed. It also notes conditions that would be important to the mount maker or the exhibition designer. To the right, you'll see a stack of little boxes. This is how I track the status of the object as it passes through the conservation process to assist in organizing the workflow. The production tab includes measurements, images, and information for mount making and for designers to prepare the needed elevations and plan drawings. Design and production are normally the first to want this information, since it defines special criteria for object display and ultimately the performance level of the display case, which then impacts the design and the budget. Performance is most often defined by how tightly sealed the case is to permit a microclimate generator or silica gel to be used to condition the interior of the case. Of course, the more tightly sealed the case, the more important it is to use materials that are safe for the objects and specimen. As I mentioned earlier, the exhibition guidelines is a reference tool for design and production. It is written by conservation and includes information related to general exhibition requirements, environmental standards, display case needs, mount requirements, and the selection of case materials, and gallery finishes. While it includes generic types of information, about those materials that were either denied or approved, all exhibit materials must pass the Oddy test to be used. Conservation has maintained the shared database that includes tests for every material tested over the past 15 years. We use the Getty protocol and are lucky enough to have Dick Bisbing, retired forensic microscopist and former VP from Macron Associates, doing our tests. Staff are encouraged to submit samples for testing. All results are entered into the shared database. The data can be viewed in a variety of forms depending on the needs of the viewer. Here is the basic information about a sample, seen with its approval highlighted in green at the upper right corner. The results of individual coupons can also be reviewed along with any comments from the person doing the test. And here, a list of tested materials after the keyword adhesives was entered into the search box. At the end of this phase, each object or specimen has been designed into the exhibit, and final conservation and installation decisions and treatment are made. All cases and layouts are drawn to scale and circulated for review on a very tightly and well-defined schedule. Corrections are made and layouts are updated. Each case is detailed in a way, in this way, and often a case is prototyped. Lighting plans are also created and approved. This phase is also when conservation tests the case for leak to determine how tightly sealed it really is. We use the Visola M14 handheld data logger with an attached GMP222 carbon dioxide probe. The probe is placed in the display case and the chamber is charged with carbon dioxide. A day later, the data is downloaded to determine the leak rate and ultimately the number of air exchanges per day. Our tightest cases to date is 0.05 air exchanges per day used for our meteorites. However, we consistently achieve 0.09 to 0.21 air exchanges per day. As noted earlier, this phase includes three reviews by directors. These milestones help ensure the exhibit stays on track, everyone's concerns have been addressed, and we are within budget. It is also a time to prevent scope creep, when great ideas of the team can be the enemy of the budget. Phase four is the production phase. It begins with reality check two, when production confirms that the budget can build the exhibition as designed. The exhibit is then fabricated, installation mounts are made, and the objects installed. John is now going to take it away and talk about how during phase three and four, conservation and production work together to solve exhibition issues for the benefit of the collection. One big issue that we have resolved was how to eliminate wood from case interiors. This caused the museum to seek new and exciting fabrication materials and techniques. John?
Thank you, Shelley. Good afternoon, everybody. Phase three and four are where we start to think about production. Anytime you undertake an exhibition, you'll encounter challenges. In phase three, we identify problems and formulate solutions. Much of how we build has changed for most institutions. The dropping costs of CNC, 3D printing, laser engraving has made this technology more readily available. Before I continue, let me go over some of the terms I'll be using. When I talk about tooling, I mean the equipment and techniques available to an institution. Digital fabrication refers to any computer-based building, and prototyping is how we prove concepts. When I mention prototype, I'll refer to mock-up and test build as well. We prototype to test how materials or techniques will actually work. A mock-up is a scaled version of a prototype, not necessarily of the actual materials. And to test build is to create a full-scale functional prototype with the intention of using it. So during phase three, we solve display challenges by figuring out how to build the design within budget and make critical decisions related to fabrication. While performance and design needs generally drive the cost, to further understand cost, we prototype. Prototyping also helps us determine the best workflow, materials, and techniques needed to complete the project. I'd like to share two examples of process today. The first example is new cases built for the Cyrus Tang Hall of China. Later I'll talk about retrofitting cases for Bunky Echo Hawk Modern Warrior, which is a temporary exhibit. And by retrofit, I'm referring to taking an existing case and altering it to either improve its look or its performance standards. So this is a shot of the Cyrus Tang Hall of China. The original intention was to have cases built by an outside vendor. After evaluation, the decision was made to build them in-house. Our first step was to prototype the case to finalize case design, so we best utilized the tooling at the museum and high skill set of our staff. This decision was not only good for the budget, It was a great opportunity to apply the case-building techniques that we developed at Field. The method used is the technique of using aluminum-clad plywood to create sealed cases and silica gel chambers and to restrict our materials to only those that have passed Oddy. Some of you might have heard me speak about this in Florida. Over 50 cases were needed for the Hall of China, some almost 20 feet long and requiring assembly on site. Through prototyping, we determined it was best to focus on the use of CNC for the needed precision and efficiency to build the cases. This detail of the face frame illustrates how we moved from a welded metal frame to using an aluminum extrusion, which could be easily cut or shaped using our CNC. This modification was preferable for four reasons. One, it was easier to control any production inconsistencies, such as size. Two, it didn't require welding, which takes more time, more skill, more resources. Three, it accomplished our environmental objective to seal the case properly. And four, it was done for far less than outsourcing. Here you see the final case frame detail in a partially completed state. Prototyping the light attic also helped us cut cost. Most often, the light attic in a display case is fully glazed like a window. Glazing requires installation of a frame to hold it and hardware to seal it. This adds time and cost to a project. In China Hall, case design called for an LED light wand to be installed in the light attic. By making a prototype, we showed how a plexiglass insert could be made instead using CNC and then inserted into the light attic from above the chamber. The insert provided space flexible enough to focus the light wand, and it eliminated the need for glazing without compromising the artifact chamber. Phase three is where we can determine which cases need silica gel chambers as well. So going from the database, we can determine which objects and artifacts need to have a controlled case environment. In China Hall, the database helped us identify cases that required chambers, which were then designed and detailed for this, making them ready for production in phase four. This is an example of one of the silica gel chambers for the cases. And this is one that was made for the cases that required assembly on site, which we really kind of needed to test drive. And this was a situation where we utilized test building something. We built it with the intention of using it when it was in the hall. And this is what it looked like when we took them down and fitted them up in the actual case in the hall. And then, of course, the final completion of the case, the artifacts installed. So the second example I'd like to talk about today is retrofitting display cases for Bunky Echo Hawk Modern Warrior. In phase three of Bunky Echo Hawk, it was determined, due to budget constraints, that we should attempt to modify existing cases to hold climate within the chamber using silica gel. In this example of prototyping, we used test build again. Once proven, the techniques could then be used to modify other existing cases at Field. So here are some of the modifications that we ultimately determined we needed. Oh, well, we've already been over that. So the existing case structure was modified to support the silica gel chamber. Here you see how plywood inserts were added directly to the case with the intent of learning the best way to augment its structure. This shows how the aluminum-clad silica gel chamber was integrated into the deck. By making it one continuous piece, it's much easier to achieve a good seal. The existing vitrines also needed modification, and this shows a technique used to drill out a corner with a router to accept an insert so that it could be screwed to the deck. By screwing to the deck, we could get a better seal. This modification also allowed us to use a simpler security measure, which saved time and materials. Once we've established a good method, we leak test the case to prove and quantify its effectiveness. Once proven, not only can we apply the technique to other applications, but we can also start refining better ways to build it, either conventionally or using CNC. And that's the completed retrofit, ready to be fit up with the display deck and the vitrine. So this concludes my examples. As we build, we learn, we share, and the methods and materials we've discussed today are posted at these locations. It's an exciting time for museums. Over the past decade, Field Museum, in particular, through testing and experimentation, has developed techniques to seal and completely remove wood products from case interiors, and to do it cost-effectively with simple conventional tooling. Now more than ever, technology is available to solve building challenges in-house. This allows us not only to save money, but to build more responsibly, which opens a range of opportunity, marketing, collections, and exhibition. Finally, in phase five, once an exhibition is open, there's time for a post-opening discussion. Here, we get an opportunity to talk about our successes and shortcomings, to determine what we want to do differently next time, or evaluate the parts of our process we think could improve. So in conclusion, process is a continuously changing and adapting mechanism that provides us not only with a system of checks and balances, but keeps us on schedule and on budget. Through the use of a structured plan, innovation through prototyping, and adaptation based on experience, not only can we refine our process, but enhance the exhibition experience for our patrons. Thank you so much for your time, and thank you, Shelley.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Shelley and John, for your presentation. So our next speaker will be Richard Newman, Strange Events Inside Display Cases at the Museum of Fine Arts Boston and Lessons to be Learned from Them, Part 1. Part 2 will be given by Pam Hatchfield in about a half an hour. So Richard Newman is the head of the scientific research at the museum, at the MFA in Boston, overseeing an analytical lab that works with conservators and curators throughout the museum and regularly collaborates with colleagues at other museums in the Boston area. He teaches a seminar on materials of works of art at Wellesley College and is a lecturer in an introductory archaeological course at MIT. Over his career, he has carried out research projects on a wide range of works of art, ranging from the paintings of Diego de Velázquez to the Buddhist and Hindu stone sculptures of India. His most recent research, in collaboration with several colleagues at other museums, has involved the characterization of a natural resin used by the Inca and artisans in Pasto, Colombia. So Richard, oh, and phones, turn them off. I realized I hadn't turned mine off either. So it's in presenter mode, and that's a pointer.
Okay, thank you. Well, we have a two-part presentation here, and I guess this part mostly deals with the strange events, and part two will deal with the lessons to be learned. I have to adjust my eyes here by taking my glasses off so I can see my notes. In 2009, the Museum of Fine Arts made its first purchases from Gopian SPA, an Italian company based in Milan that has focused on the manufacture of display cases for over 60 years. And I believe this is a picture of perhaps Gopian's very first display case, made in 1952. This is one of the earliest cases at the Museum of Fine Arts we purchased, again, from 2009. In 2010, the museum opened its new American wing in which all the display cases were manufactured by Gopian. This is one of those galleries. Since then, many renovations of older galleries in the old part of the museum have also featured Gopian cases, including a gallery with the museum's excavated material from Middle Kingdom Egypt, an ancient coins gallery, and a gallery with objects from Benin. I asked the museum's head designer, Keith Crippen, for some comments on Gopian cases. And this is what he wrote. In part, it reads, Gopian understands museums and their needs regarding education, conservation, and design more thoroughly and intimately than any vendor I've worked with. The MFA currently has 424 Gopian cases of all sizes and shapes spread throughout many galleries and housing works of art of a very wide variety. The structural materials of Gopian cases are steel and laminated glass. Two types of gaskets are utilized. the magnetic type mainly on the doors, and in this example of a smaller type Gulpian case, the pink-colored gasket rising vertically would be the magnetic type gasket on the door of that particular display case. They also use compressible silicon gaskets in hidden areas, such as around the silica gel compartment, and that would be at the very bottom of this particular case design. Gulpian also uses a variety of commercial adhesives and sealants to adhere glass to glass, glass to metal, or gaskets to glass and metal. Gulpian's cases are typically constructed to allow one air exchange every 10 days. They can be constructed to be much more airtight than that. Before we purchased our first cases, a number of in-house Oddy tests were carried out on samples of adhesive, sealants, and gaskets provided to us by Gulpian. We didn't note any reactions in any of the tests we carried out on these materials. Other institutions, such as the British Museum, have also carried out Oddy tests on some of the same materials used by Gulpian, and also, to the best of our knowledge, have not noted any reactions with the metal coupons. I wanted to mention the peroxide cured silicon gaskets that were used for a number of years in Gulpian cases. We've also used these in in-house manufactured cases at the MFA for many years, and we've tested them before more than once. And although not all of them pass, many of these gaskets manufactured by this particular process do pass the Oddy test. In September 2014, we noticed crystals on a gasket in one of our tabletop cases in our at that time relatively new coin gallery. The gasket is situated between the lid that opens, that's the lid at the angle that you see in that picture at the upper right, and the bottom part of the case, the fixed bottom part of the case, and it's meant to ensure the airtightness of the case when you close the lid down on the bottom part and lock the case shut. Shortly thereafter, we noticed in conversations with some colleagues, it was suggested that the crystals on the gaskets were the result of a reaction between a component and one of the adhesives that is one of the prominent adhesives used in the Gulpian manufacturing process, and a compound found in the silicon gasket itself. Less than a month afterwards, crystals were noticed on the surfaces of two Native American ceramics in another Gulpian case. These are the two ceramics here. Pre-crystal, so to speak, so you can't see the crystals in either of them in these images. These observations prompted us to systematically examine our display cases and the works of art in them. We've been looking closely at our Gulpian cases that were manufactured between 2009 and 2014, focusing on three phenomena, and I show these here. First of all, the crystals on or near the gaskets. These are not always present on the silicon gaskets, but they're relatively common. The gaskets are hidden from view, so the cases need to be open in order to search for these crystals. A viewer will never see these in going into the gallery, nor will a staff member unless we happen to open the right part of the case. Secondly, crystals on works of art. And I think almost everyone in the audience will agree that this is a rather horrifying object to look at with the crystals on it. But this is our most extreme example of crystals that we found in one of our cases. There are only four objects to date that have had any kind of visible crystals on them at all. And again, this is the most extreme instance. This is one of the Native American objects that we first noticed crystals on. The third phenomenon is hazes on the inside of glass panels in the cases. Hazes had been noticed before on some Gulpian cases. They had been cleaned off, although they were not always easy to remove, and they sometimes recurred. Not all cases exhibit hazes, and not all glass panels in a given case may show a visible haze. Very rarely cases show all three of these phenomena. Others may show one or two, others none at all. In some instances, the phenomena were noted in cases that were relatively recently installed, but in other instances, the phenomena didn't seem to develop, or at least were not noticed until well after installation. So we have a somewhat mysterious situation, several things occurring, and at the beginning of our research, we didn't really know what was going on, and whatever was going on didn't go on all the time in all our cases. So we were a little bit mystified. I'll discuss all of these three phenomena in turn. We utilize FTIR microspectroscopy, scanning electron microscopy, pyrolysis GCMS, and liquid chromatography mass spectrometry to study samples we've taken from our display cases or the works of art within them. To begin with the crystals on the gaskets. Crystals on a gasket may be rather large, as in this picture at the upper left, or they may be rather small, seeming more like a white haze on the gasket rather than any kind of visible crystal. Crystals sometimes are also present on nearby metal surfaces, such as shown in the lower left. This metal surface was very close to the gasket you show at the upper, you see at the upper left. The scanning electron microscope image of one sample at the right shows that the crystals are needle-like. The cross-section view of one crystal at the far left of that image field, let's see, maybe I can get this to work. Or maybe not. Never mind. The one of the crystals at the very far left of that image looks kind of like a ribbon on its side. We're getting a side view of it. It's twisted a little bit like a ribbon. That's probably the morphology of the crystals and shows that they're somewhat flexible in nature. TerraSat 9220 is one of the construction materials prominently used by Gopian over a number of years, the period of time we're talking about in particular, 2009 to 2014, in their cases. And we know, as I'll discuss more in the next few minutes, that this is one of the construction materials that contributed to the formation of the crystals on the gaskets and some of the other phenomena I'm going to talk about. It's currently manufactured by the German company Hinkle. Is described in their product literature, as you see there, as a single component constructive adhesive for bonding and weld bonding of panels and components on cars, trucks, and buses. Not made for the museum market, clearly, but it has been tested. It was tested by a number of institutions, including ours, and it didn't seem to have any problems, at least as indicated by the Oddy test. The adhesive in TerraSat 9220 is something called an MS polymer, a silane modified polyether. MS polymers were developed in Japan in the 1980s and are considered a kind of green alternative to more traditional adhesives used for similar purposes. These more traditional adhesives usually contain isocyanates and solvents, whereas MS polymers are a single component adhesive that sets through reaction with water in the air. They don't release any solvents. They don't involve rather nasty materials like isocyanates in their manufacturing process. The other significant component in TerraSat 9220, although it's a very minor one by weight, is Tinovin 770. The name Tinovin was trademarked by Seba Geigy in 1976. The trademark is currently held by BASF. Tinovin 770, which is the specific product found in TerraSat 9220, was actually the first Tinovin developed by Seba Geigy, and thus it's been on the market for nearly 40 years now. Tinovins are used to stabilize coatings and plastics against deterioration by absorbing ultraviolet radiation, or by scavenging free radicals created by photodegradation. There are types of tinovins that do one or the other of these, and you can combine different tinovins so that to do both of these things. BASF currently markets nearly two dozen different types of products called tinovins. Eight of these, including tinovin 770, are what are called hindered amine light stabilizers, or HALS, or HALS. The active part of all HALS type tinovins is a derivative of the compound that you see at the left, 2266 tetramethyl piperidine. This is not a compound that's actually used in the HALS, but it's used to make derivatives such as the two that you see at the right, and these are then reacted with an inert ingredient to make the particular variety of tinovin, the actual molecule found in the tinovin product that you purchase on the market. The simplest derivative at the upper right, that's one that I will call TMP in this paper because acronyms are a good thing, as we heard from, as we heard earlier today. Plus, I don't think I can pronounce the word correctly more than once, so we'll call that TMP. Remember, that's the molecule I'll be talking about. That's a particular derivative that's combined with an inert component I'll talk about more in a moment. And that's found in tinovin 770. And as far as I know, that's the only tinovin on the market that has this particular derivative in it. The derivative at the lower right has an additional methyl group attached to the nitrogen atom. And this derivative is used in the manufacture of tinovin 292. And tinovin 292 is something that paintings conservators, in particular in the audience, will probably be well familiar with. In a landmark 1990 publication, Rene Delary and Chris McGlinchey at the National Gallery here in WDC showed that the addition of tinovin 292 to Damar varnish could prevent the yellowing of that natural resin when exposed to visible light. This behavior was confirmed in a recent Journal of the Canadian Conservation Association paper that described natural light aging of various natural and synthetic varnishes. That's tinovin 292. The molecule that comprises tenavin 770, and this is the tenavin that's present in Terastat, it's a ester of TMP and sabacic acid, as you see at the top. That's the molecule. Tenavin 770 is currently the only tenavin product approved for indirect contact with food. That is in polymer-based packaging, which food products might be packaged for sale or storage. It's usually added at a level of only 1 to 2% to products of which it's a part. We found in recent analyses that tenavin 770 always contains a small amount of free TMP. This is never noted in product literature, but BASF did confirm that they add TMP in slight excess during the manufacturing to ensure that the condensation reaction with sabacic acid proceeds to completion. The amount of free TMP in tenavin 770 apparently depends on the manufacturer, possibly even the batch of product from a single manufacturer. Analyses at the University of Turin of a few bottles of tenavin from different manufacturers suggest that the amount may vary between 0.5 and 1.5% by weight. To the best of our knowledge, there's one published paper that notes the presence of free TMP in tenavin 770. There appear to be no health concerns about tenavin 770, particularly since it's only ever used in consumer products as a low-level additive, typically, as I mentioned, 1 to 2%. Since it's a base, TMP can be dangerous to handle and will cause burns on the skin, but again, because it would only be encountered at an extremely low level in commercial products, it's not thought to be of any concern. According to a research document produced in 2002 by a consortium of Japanese manufacturers and reviewed by the Japanese government, TMP's only use is as an intermediate compound in the manufacture of HALS. And again, the only type of HALS that I'm aware of that contains TMP as one of its components would be the tenavin 770 that's used in Terastat 9220 and other products, including a lot of those plastic wrappers that lunches we ate today might have come in. As this simple diagram indicates, Terastat 9220 is about 98% MS polymer with some inert black pigmentation and around 2% tenavin. Of the 2% tenavin, perhaps 1 to 2% is free TMP by weight. TMP is a volatile molecule. The free TMP is the specific compound that's involved in the formation of the crystals on the gaskets. Not the MS polymer, not the pigmentation, not the tenavin 770 molecule, but the free TMP that's left over from the manufacturing process of the tenavin 770. The silicon gaskets on which crystals form are manufactured with a cross-linking reagent, 2,4-dichlorobenzoyl peroxide. This is still the method that's used for many types of silicon gaskets. It's a standard one. I think it's less expensive than the alternatives at the moment. Freshly manufactured gaskets are usually baked to destroy residual peroxide, but this leaves behind certain small molecules that can be leached or extracted from the gasket. There's no indication that any of these are volatile, but they certainly can be leached or extracted. And since products made by this method are used in health industries, for example, there have been a number of published studies specifically testing the amount of the residual products from the peroxide that can be extracted from a plastic tube, for example, or a gasket. One of these extractable compounds is 2,4-dichlorobenzoic acid, which I will only refer to as DCB from now on. That's the other acronym I'll be using in the talk. The crystals on the gaskets are actually a salt of TMP and DCB. These crystals can readily be identified from their infrared spectrum, which is quite distinctive, as you see here. We tried our best, and we asked Thermal Scientific to help us correlate this spectrum with any available database, but nobody was able to correlate it with anything. So in other words, this compound that hasn't been noted or researched or any spectroscopic data has ever been acquired on it prior to this time, as far as we know. In our research, we call this the type A spectrum. And again, it's a fairly simple compound between TMP, which is a base, and DCB, which is an acid. This sketch is a simple summary of what is happening. TMP is volatilizing from Terastat 9220. Terastat 9220, of course, some of it is exposed to the air inside the display case, and it is a somewhat volatile compound. So it comes out of the tenavin, that's a minor component of the Terastat itself, goes into the air, distributes throughout the air, And when it encounters a silicon gasket made by with this peroxide catalyst that has some DCB in it, crystals form on the gasket, making this very simple salt. Crystals also can form nearby the gasket, so we know that DCB can move at least a short distance away from the gasket, but DCB itself doesn't seem to be very volatile. This is it's very simple to make the TMP DCB salt. This is the fast method for those of us that don't have much patience. You can take a piece of black paper, you can soak it in a solution of TMP and let it dry. Then you can take another piece of black paper and soak it in a solution of DCB and let that dry. You can put the two pieces of paper together, not touching each other, in a vial, like the exact same one you use for an Oddy test, cap it, stick it in an oven for a couple hours at 60 Celsius. And of course, depending on the concentration of the ingredients in your pieces of paper, you'll get crystals forming on the piece of paper that contain the DCB. You don't get any kind of visible crystals forming on the piece of paper that contain the TMP. And this correlates with what we saw in the gaskets and the cases. The TMP moves to the DCB, but the DCB doesn't appear to move to the TMP. We do see crystals on the side of the glass here too, so again, the DCB does move a little distance out of the paper sometimes, but mostly the TMP goes to the DCB source. So the TMP out of the pterostat goes to the silicon gasket, not the other way around. A slower method of doing the same thing, is to actually taking a piece of the gasket, the silicon gasket, and a piece of dry pterostat adhesive, as you see here. You can run this as an Oddy test. You can put the metal coupons up in the upper part of the glass tube, stick it in the oven at the 60 Celsius, a little water, so forth. And over the period of the Oddy test, the white haze will form on the silicon gasket. And as I think you can see here, some white haze will also form on the edges of the glass tube, but my kind of crummy photo with my phone doesn't show those crystals on the side of the tube here. So this is a slow method of manufacturing the crystals, but again, this is the type A spectrum crystal, exact same material we made with the black pieces of paper, exact same compound we found on the gaskets. And I'll discuss the second and third phenomena together because they're very closely related, as you'll see in a moment, although they wouldn't seem to be. Again, our poster child ceramic with the very large crystals on it. We use a piece of double-sided carbon adhesive tape that we can put in the SEM to touch to the surface of this ceramic and then look at the crystals that we pulled off directly in the SEM, and that's what you see at the right. They don't look very much like crystals, more look like shreds of material that have been torn apart. They are a crystalline compound, but obviously a very soft, almost waxy-like one. And down below, then, are a couple examples of hazes. To sample hazes, we usually use a razor blade to scrape over a little bit of the surface of the glass inside the case when we open it. We transfer those to a glass slide, and then we transfer some of those crystals to the same carbon adhesive tape and look at it in the SEM. The SEM images are a little bit fuzzy. They weren't taken under the optimal conditions for this kind of imaging of this kind of material. But they clearly contain little crystals, little tiny ones we can't really see very well, but they're definitely there. And as it turns out, the shreds on the ceramic and the crystals below are the exact same compound. This is a chloride salt, the TMP. So TMP from the pterostat is involved in the formation of these crystals. But the anion involved is chloride, simple chloride. And this, again, produces a very distinctive infrared spectrum. We call this the type B spectrum. Again, this is a spectrum that doesn't correspond to anything in any database of IR spectra that we're aware of. It's a very distinctive one. It's a very easy way to identify the compound. And again, it's a chloride. In the case of the ceramic, it's easy to guess that the chlorine comes from maybe the burial environment. It was in the ceramic itself. In the glass hazes, it's a little more difficult to figure out where the chloride's coming from, and we haven't actually figured that out yet. Might be on the glass itself from something used to clean the glass. We don't really know yet. But again, the glass hazes, the most common type of glass haze we've seen in our gropion cases, and the crystals that we've seen on objects, and again, very few objects with crystals on them, it's the exact same compound, the salt, the TMP, and chloride, which you can easily make in your own laboratory with minimal equipment and samples. You can put TMP with, together with a little bit of dilute hydrochloric acid or even a solution of table salt, let it evaporate to dryness, and the crystals left behind will be the salt, the TMP chloride salt with the same infrared spectrum that I showed you, the ones we got from the ceramics and from the glass hazes. TMP also reacts with many other types of acids. So you can react it with, for example, acetic acid, formic acid, palmitic acid, other acids, and make TMP salts of those particular acids. Finally, we occasionally found a different type of glass haze composition. Not too commonly, but we call this our type C spectrum. Its spectrum is shown here, and some of you that do infrared spectroscopy will recognize that this is a pretty indicative of a benzoic acid salt of some kind. And from the SEM analysis, we know it's a sodium benzoic acid salt. And again, it only forms on glass. We don't know what the source of the benzoic acid is at the moment, and we don't know what the source of the sodium is. The sodium probably comes from the glass, but we don't know exactly how that's occurring. We haven't actually done any studies of the glass itself to further pursue the question of how the chloride salt of TMP forms on the glass or how this benzoic acid salt forms. But again, in this particular, this third type spectrum, we don't know where the benzoic acid comes from. So this is my simple little diagram of that third type spectrum with lots of unknown, lots of questions at the moment. And then finally, I'm making this talk a little on the short side so we can have more time for Pam to talk and then more time to ask questions to all the panel afterwards. So this is my final slide. Just to summarize, the air inside the well-sealed display case, our well-sealed Gopion display cases with one air exchange every 10 days or so, if they're well-sealed, that's what their air exchange rate will be. The air inside these cases is separated from the air in the gallery surrounding it, and that's a very good thing, as we've heard from David Saunders and many others today, if you wish to create a microclimate in the case, with silica gel, for instance, as we sometimes do in our cases. That's a very good thing to have a sealed case, or to keep dust out of the case, or to keep other pollutants that might be in the gallery air outside the case. The disadvantage, of course, is that volatile compounds, which come from anything inside the case, whether it's a construction material or the work of art or the works of art in the case, those can become concentrated inside the case since there's so little air exchange. They might become much more concentrated in the case than they would be concentrated in the air outside the gallery. If you had a very leaky case, these compounds will go away much more quickly and you might never see any kind of evidence of them being in the case. We generally carry out only Oddy tests on materials that are being used in our cases. We don't do thorough testing of the air inside display cases very often, in fact, almost never, since it's expensive and doesn't really fit into the time frame, the rather truncated time frame of putting together exhibitions frequently, designing and putting together exhibitions. In the future, however, we might do more of this after what we've seen in the Gopion cases and what other people have seen. We assume that our simple Oddy tests and review of product information will ensure that no compounds dangerous to cultural artifacts will build up inside the display case, but the Oddy metal canaries will not necessarily react with all compounds that might be volatilized from materials being tested. That's a no-brainer to all of us in the audience today. We've already heard examples of that and discussion of that. But TMP, this one particular unusual molecule, is the case in point. Did not react with any of the metal coupons. We didn't even know it was there, in fact. In fact, when we began this project, I had never heard of TMP before, and I wager to say that there's almost nobody in the audience who hasn't been involved in this project that's probably ever heard of TMP. I'd also wager to say that most of us have probably breathed in TMP at a low level during most of our lives, and we probably even ingested some of it, since it is approved for contact with food. And it has been a product, and this particular kind of tinnitus that's been on the market for nearly 40 years now. But the level is so low, the level of tinnitus in any product is so low, and the level of free TMP in the tinnitus is so low that there's no concern by anyone about ingesting a little bit of tinnitus or ingesting a little bit of TMP. We obviously know during our Oddy test when we didn't see any evidence of TMP inside the glass test tube. If we had tested for TMP with SPME or some other technique we'll hear about later today, we would have detected TMP in the air. But we had no way of seeing this tiny little molecule, no way of detecting it, didn't have any reaction, so we didn't even know it was there until we saw evidence of it in these two types of salts that we saw inside some of our display cases. Terastat 9220 that contains the 10 of the 770, it's made for a market, obviously very different than the Mizen market, but it's made to be used in circumstances where there would be ample air exchange. So it's a perfectly safe product for the uses for which it's intended, and nobody would be exposed to much tenavin or TMP under those circumstances. For example, welding two pieces of metal together in a car. The ample air exchange, you're not going to be exposed to any of those chemicals. So again, for its ordinary uses, Terastat 9220 would be a very good material and is a very good material with a very good track record. And it's only if you allow this one very low-level compound to build up that you can even detect it in any kind of reaction might occur, just because the levels are so low in ordinary circumstances. The strange events, as we're calling them, that occurred in our Gopion cases, they're a result of unique circumstances, probably restricted to Gopion cases of a certain vintage, unless Terastat 9220 in particular, or something else with tenavin 770 happens to be used in the manufacture of display cases by any other manufacturer within any museum setting. As of about a year ago, Terastat 9220 is no longer used by Gopion, so there won't be a TMP source in more recent vintage Gopion cases. That's why in the case of the MFA, it's our 2009 to 2014 cases where we might see this problem. But as I mentioned, we don't see the problem too often. We don't understand why we don't often see it, although we do open and shut our cases a number of times, fairly frequently sometimes, so we might be airing them out enough to prevent TMP from building up to the point where some kind of reaction can occur. There could be other strange and unanticipated events that could conceivably occur in various display cases in our museum or in your museum in the future, no matter where and by whom those cases were manufactured. As we learn more about the somewhat unexplored territory inside display cases, perhaps we in the conservation profession can work together to ensure that there will be fewer strange events in the future. Thank you.
So thank you, Richard. The last speaker of today before the panel discussion will be Pam Hatchfield, also from MFA Boston, part two of the previous lecture. Pam Hatchfield is the Robert P. and Carol T. Henderson Head of Objects Conservation at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. She received graduate degrees in art history and conservation from the Conservation Center Institute of Fine Arts at New York University, and is a conservation consultant to the Via La Petra NYU Florence. Her publications include Pollutants in the Museum Environment, Practical Strategies for Problem Solving in Exhibition Design and Storage. Other publications, presentations, and teaching include The Museum Environment, Ancient Gilding Methods, Stone Consolidation, Filling and Compensation Methods for Archaeological Objects, and the Treatment of Asian Lacquer. Her current research interests include the technology of Mayan ceramics and laser cleaning techniques. Pam is a fellow of the AIC and the IIC and presently serves as president of AIC and FAIC. She serves on the board of directors for the U.S. Committee of the Blue Shield and is a fellow of the American Academy in Rome. To Pam.
Well, hi, everybody. I know that some of you have jet lag, and I wore bright colors today, not really thinking about that, but I'm going to try to wake you all up. Although I know this has been a really interesting day for me and for all of you as well, I hope. And I just want to say a big thank you to Tiarna for giving us the opportunity to present two talks. I realize that time was very precious here, and we're really grateful for that. And I think it speaks to the collaborative nature of our project and the fact that there are many authors and many colleagues who have participated in this and will continue to do so in the future. So Richard mentioned that these papers, these two papers, are reporting the ongoing results of this collaborative project, which is between the MFA, Gopion, the Aerospace Corporation, one of the companies that works entirely for NASA, the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, also NASA. Do I have to tell you what that stands for? No, that's another acronym. And the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. Richard described to you the history of this really interesting issue at the MFA, what we saw and what compounds were identified. And I'm going to go into a little bit of detail for you today about what happened and what we did about it. So I just want to add a little bit of context, and we've talked about some of these other strange, or not so strange, more common kinds of reactions that have occurred in exhibition cases and storage environments, and here you see the MFA Asian storage, ceramic storage area where we've had a host of problems going on since the 1980s. And here's a very fine example which has been published before, which is a lead formate crystal encrusted bowl. That was not an original design element, unfortunately. but it looks like it. It's lead formate on a leaded copper alloy bowl. So these are birch veneered plywood cabinets coated with an alkyd resin varnish. And these were built, I think, about 1980. We analyzed these in 1986, or this environment in 1986, and again in 1997, and found elevated concentrations of acetic and formic acids and formaldehyde inside these cabinets. And here, lest you think that these wonderful crystals are forming only on, or hazes are forming only on glass, this is a vintage case from the MFA Old Kingdom Gallery, dating from around 1960, and this had become so cloudy that we actually couldn't see through it at all when it was taken down in preparation for our new American wing. So Richard mentioned briefly the hazes on glass. I also created another one myself, and I hope you're proud of me because this is a personal object of mine. It's a cellulose nitrate dish made to imitate tortoiseshell, and this very thick layer is of inorganic nitrates, probably sodium and potassium nitrate. Probably the potassium and sodium are from the glass itself. So construction materials are the culprit in the first instance, and in the second, the object itself. Now, here are some other images of hazing on museum glass in other places, and Helen Ganiaris at the Museum of London has been looking at this phenomenon for quite a while and has identified a range of contaminants, including formate salts, sodium chloride, hydrocarbons. And this phenomenon there and also at the Royal Ontario Museum, and I suspect many other places, seems to exist independently of fabrication method, of the manufacturer, of the location, of the climate, the exhibit case contents, and other factors. It seems pretty random, in fact. And at the ROM, researchers found both organic and inorganic sodium salts, including sodium chloride and hydrocarbons, which probably were transferred from production machinery. And you might be able to see this kind of track that looks like it was a machine that was drawing the glass along during the fabrication process. Researchers in Norway and the United Kingdom recently published the generation of, or identified the generation of organic acids, aldehydes, and ketones from aged canvas samples and characterized the affinity of acetic acid to deposit on glass. So the question really is, why do hazes form so readily on glass of all kinds? And here I want to introduce the concept of the cold plate, which is also known in the trade as a cold getter or cold finger. I kind of love that. And here is one, a liquid cold plate, they're called. We all know that glass is a very poor thermal conductor and that everything condenses on the coldest surface in the area, which is often the glass. So that's a hint as to why we have all this deposition on glass. So I think I'll just skip this explanation, but these are used inside vacuum systems often, and they're used a lot by NASA, to extract gaseous and vapors, other vapor phase species from a process in which they're trying to produce something and remove it from the system as a whole. So here's quickly a few other examples of crystals on objects. This is a study that was done in 2007 at the MFA. There were about 200 objects collected in the late 19th, early 20th century by William Sturgis Bigelow, a trustee. And I just had to include him because he has the best facial hair I think I've ever seen. I just love this man. He was clearly very proud of it. He kept it till he was old and gray, and his picture is proudly displayed in the Asian department, curatorial department. So since the early 80s, this collection has been stored in closed plywood cabinets like the ones you just saw. This project was trying to sort out how much of the damage that we saw on this material was from unstable glass and how much from the storage environment. And we couldn't really answer the question, but there was an amazing 40% of the glass in initial stages of deterioration with these hazy or greasy or crystalline surfaces. We never really answered the question, except that the most unstable glasses in the collection were high in potassium and low in calcium. So there's more to be done in the area of looking at unstable glass and understanding these processes that we're dealing with in museum environments now. Here's another really interesting example of the kinds of crystals that appear amazingly on artwork from time to time. And this was published in 2012 in AIC News by scientists from the Met. And they are examples of amine deposits or efflorescences on wood, for one, and on a ceramic vase in the other. And they were created by reactions caused by tertiary amines used as catalysts in the production of polyester polyurethane foam. And these objects were stored in that foam for long periods of time, and when they were removed from storage, this was found. And the Met, I know there's at least one person here from the Met who would be available, I'm sure, to talk about the method that they devised for doing solid phase micro extraction on Oddy testing vessels. And I'm really interested in hearing how all of that is going at the Met. So hopefully we'll have a chance to catch up about that later. But I just wanted to present that because you may have not all seen that interesting publication. And then, just when you'd seen it all, you thought you'd seen it all, you find this unbelievable story about the Museo Civico di Storia Naturale in Verona, known for its spectacular collection of marine fossils and lithics. And in 2008, the collections were moved from their past location into newly restored storage area and placed in newly prepared cabinets. And not very long after, the curator noticed a very strange and very distinctive blue coloration on some of the flints. And in 2010, they analyzed these at the University of Padua and found that there was pervasive contamination by various hydrocarbons, plasticizers like phthalates and BHT, butylated hydroxy toluene. And the sources of these were from the liners in the drawers. And you can see the liners here, and a blue flint here, and a blue flint here. And I, you know, would like to teach a collections care class just so that I could show this slide as an example of what you probably shouldn't do when you handle artifacts. Anyway, I love this picture. I just love it. I mean, heads rolled over this, and here she is. Anyway, I'm sorry. Sorry. So here you see one of the flints and an acetone extract of this material, and you can see that it's really a surface phenomenon. It occurs just on the surface here. And all the analytical work that they did, the scientists did, failed to detect any of the typical colorants that we're familiar with, like copper, cobalt, or commonly known organic dyes. So they actually had to produce new names for these compounds. And I was hoping that they had done more work. I just contacted the scientist again, and their funding was cut, so they couldn't do any more work on that. But anyhow, I thought you should see it. So for our American wing, we very carefully approached the selection of materials, or so we thought. And you know, as Richard said, we did our Oddy testing, we evaluated, we looked at the MSDS, the technical data sheets, we talked to manufacturers, we thought we were familiar with the materials. And I want to point out that the cases, in many instances, were actually, the interiors were constructed by MFA staff in our own carpentry shop with materials that we have been familiar with. But we still didn't end up without problems. So here is the case that these objects came out of that Richard showed. And interestingly, we took three off view because they all seemed to have problems. But in fact, only two of them did, these two. And we thought at first maybe there was an air current. Why would it just form on these two and not any of the others? Many of them were from the same collector. They had been stored or exhibited in similar conditions. And this one looked so similar, but in fact, it was just an ordinary burial accretion. And I'll show you another example of that again. So this was very mysterious to us, and we were not at all clear, and we're still not at all clear on why they form on some objects and others. And here's some other beautiful pictures of our poster child. This is the type B crystals, the TMP chloride. So chlorine is in there. It's not hard to imagine on a burial object that there would be chlorine chlorides about. However, I want to describe the type B crystals as being incredibly fluffy and soft, and I hope that you can see that here. They almost blow away. It's almost like the drifts of light snow in Boston in February when it's very dry, very cold. Oh, sorry, I shouldn't mention that. So these crystals are very different from the kind that strike fear in the heart of most objects conservators. And here we, I think, have a combination of the more usual chlorides that come from burial, but also formate salts. And once we started seeing crystals in a few cases, we started to see them all over the collection. It's very interesting to understand the range of problems that we have, clearly because objects have absorbed acids and aldehydes from their storage or exhibition environments. So this one was obviously not, I shouldn't say obviously, it was not the same issue at all, but it, you know, from outside the case, it looked like it could be more of this happening. And here are close-ups of some different types of crystals. This is beautiful, soft, fluffy TMP crystals. This is the formates and a few others. And then this is a phosphate, which, you know, we started noticing these things everywhere. And this is actually a phosphate, and we think it was recently cleaned and installed in a new gallery, and we think that it might have been cleaned at some point in its previous history with trisodium phosphate, and that there was a residue left underneath this metal, and once it was cleaned again, it leached out from underneath. So some other pots which we looked at from a central case in the ancient Americas, and this is one we took out rather, not that recently anymore, but this seemed to have the crystals on it. This one did also, a Zea pot, and actually this one, it was sitting right next to this one, and I just put this picture in because you can't really see the other pot here, but they're sitting right next to each other. The curators went in there and reversed them, you see, but anyway, they were sitting right next to each other, and this one is totally unrelated compound, and this one of the TMP on it. So here's a close-up that you can see, which is very, very visible on the black. And so that became a poster child for what to do, and more about that in a minute. In the meantime, our colleagues at the University of Turin in the chemistry department were very hard at work studying the TMP evolution from Terastat, trying to characterize it and find out, most importantly, whether it was a degradation product or whether it, in fact, is just there in excess and goes off over time. And in fact, using solid phase microextraction, they determined that it was not a degradation product, The evolution of this excess, this small amount of excess of TMP. So they heated a sample and determined that the evolution of TMP goes up sharply and then goes down to zero. And so they did this by heating it, and then they did another test at room temperature, and they measured again and found that the very high or relatively high levels in that they generated under the test conditions went down to zero over a period of, I don't know, 30 days, you could say, at room temperature. So now we come to the statue of Senegema Mehi. I wish I had an acronym for that. So as many of you know, a lot of fragile objects, when they're excavated in the field, are treated or were treated with wax in order to stabilize them for travel, enough to get them out of the field and across the sea to far-flung museums. And these materials ranged from things like paraffin to crayons. And in fact, we still do this today. We have a fancier name and a more volatile wax. Our waxes are better, cyclododecane. And I know there's somebody here in the audience who's researching this right now. You know who you are. So this sculpture had been treated extensively in the field and consolidated with wax. It had periodically shown a white haze, which looks suspicious and could be, you know, burial salts. Was wax at least one point in its life, and of course we found this in one of our beautiful cases and decided we'd better test it, and in fact this one was found to be a wax degradation product and not related to TMP. However, this one, which was just sampled last week, in fact is a TMP related compound. It's the type B crystal, so the chlorine related, the chlorides on the mask itself. This is heavily, just completely soaked with wax, with shellac, with wood putty, with all kinds of things. It's an amazingly important object, very early object, and really, really important. But it was heavily treated when it arrived at the museum in the 1960s. And this haze is type B. We actually did not find the TMP or any TMP-related compound on the gasket in this cabinet. In this case, we actually found calcium carbonate on the gasket instead. So this is very mysterious to me. And this one was actually made to look like a Gopion case, but it was entirely made in our carpentry shop with glass that was sourced locally. We came up with the type C crystals on this glass. I also took a sample from the wall itself, and weirdly, that turned out to be type C crystals, but also alkyd resin. Now, we know that the paint itself is not an alkyd resin. It's a water-based PVA, or acrylic, rather. And so this is very strange, and we're wondering whether this back-painted glass could have been an alkyd resin paint. So we don't know where that's coming from. So there were TMP crystals in this case, and you can see the, I hope you can see the haze up here. I tried to find them on this object, and I was unable to do so, and I'm just wondering, I have no idea if this is correct, since this compound reacts with acids, perhaps it's not really reacting with this stone because it might not be saturated with acid, or it's a more alkaline material. I don't really understand why we don't typically find it, or we haven't seen it yet on stone, and we've been looking. Okay, so mitigation, what do we do about this, and does it appear to be harmful to objects? This was a very simple cleaning test that I did on the black Maria Martinez pot that you saw earlier, and it cleaned. I didn't want to use water on this pot. It cleaned very easily just with ethanol. And we don't see damage on the surface of this pot or the other pot that I cleaned, which is this one. I tried to give you a clear before and after, so you see these fluffy crystals. I think we had already sampled over here with a brush. They just came right off. And then this area is cleaned, and you don't see, under the microscope, you do not see any alteration of the surface at all. So what do we do about the haze on the glass? Similarly, I was expecting to have problems because in certain other areas of the museum, we've had terrible sort of greasy films that seem very hard to remove. In this case, the glass, I did a bunch of tests with a bunch of different kind of cleaning materials, and the thing that really worked the most easily with no residue at all was water and ethanol or isopropanol, which is what we normally use to clean our glass. So that was a very happy discovery, and it does not seem very complicated. So what can we do? Be careful. All we can say is be careful. We can actually do more than that. And here I present a wonderful new filtration system that Gopion has designed in consultation with many other partners, including a fan, a filter unit, an electrical power box, and I'll turn to the next. And so the filtration runs through the silica gel compartment. And here it is being tested at the University of Turin. And I'll show you a breakout of this in a minute. But basically, there's an electrical box here. There's the filtration in the fan unit, and then the tubes go up to the silica gel compartment, and the air is filtered through the silica gel compartment and through these filters, which I'll talk about in a second, that are in here. And you have two sampling ports, one innie and one outie, so that you can actually check the efficiency of those filters. It's a very ingenious design, I think. Here's the filtration unit. And basically, there's a lot of hardware, and then these are the carbon filters. It's a special kind of carbon filter that I'll talk about in a minute. The filter is a new product called Purabead that's made by Purifil, and it's a carbon-based mat made of polyurethane foam, which has these spherical carbon beads. It has a particular affinity for alkaline gases. In addition to removing acidic gases, hydrogen sulfide and sulfur dioxide, and a whole range of other organic gases, but it seems particularly well-suited for these alkaline and amine type compounds like TMP. So here is a sort of breakout of the test, and this so this is the sampling point where the air comes in, so you can sample with SPME here, and then where it comes out, and these are the Purabead filters that are inside here, and here is their testing source of TMP, and again you see this high level of TMP going into the filter and then very low level going out. They also tested for outgassing from materials, and this is basically the breakout of the testing methodology in which they're using SPME fibers and going to GCMS for the analytical work. So it's pretty quick. We've also turned to the aerospace industry for help. They're very concerned about off-gassing as well, not necessarily because they care about us, but because they care about astronauts and satellites and mirrors and deep space and that kind of thing. So we've been talking to them in a couple of different ways and learning more about their testing methods, which include a couple of ASTM standard tests which they use, and there is a wonderful outgassing database that's unfortunately very antiquated and hard to use, but there's a lot of good information in it, and it is available to the public, and there'll be a lot more discussion about this shortly. But so these testing standards are something for us all to consider as we try to move to the next phase of testing materials for use in museums. Now I want to introduce a really exciting thing, which was a concept developed by Ken Suslick at the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. And he calls it the optoelectronic nose. The idea is that you can use a colorimetric test to give a unique signature or fingerprint to a wide range of volatile compounds. You image it before and after, and this is possible because there are 7 billion people out there all wanting to use their iPhones to make pictures, so we have this wonderfully developed technology at this point where you can do this imaging, this digital imaging. And the idea is that you image before and after and you get a color difference map. It is very exciting from our point of view. It was initially looked at by Michael Schilling at the Getty to develop the technology with Ken, who's been using it for a long time. And it has been originally developed for the Department of Defense to detect toxic vapors, explosives, and all this kind of thing. And also now for biomedical fields, they can actually detect, apparently they can detect cancer just by taking a breath sample from someone. So there's a whole range of basically spot tests. They are nano particulate in some cases. They're very, very small particles of metals or other things. But a lot of these you'll be familiar with, pH indicators. And basically they can design this in any way that we think is important for our field. So we're very, very excited about this. It has been used once. Oh. That's interesting. Oh, there we go. Okay, before exposure, during exposure, this is an example of ammonia. The changes are boxed in gray, and then you see the difference map. And the difference map tells you, apparently, the intensity, but also the presence of these compounds, or a particular compound, at a very high level of detection. So, very low limits of recognition, and as I mentioned, they're using this to detect pathogenic bacteria in human breath, which is really kind of amazing. So the first example of the use of this has been recently the Disney Museum sent animation cells to China, and they were very, very concerned about the problems that they might have with the terrible pollution and the sensitivity of the animation cells. So Ken worked with them to develop an app for that. It's not really an app, but they used imaging on an iPhone. And they, actually I think the exhibit is still there, but so they have an array inside the passepartout that the objects are traveling in. They have one on the outside. And interestingly, they discovered that one of the materials that the passepartouts were made out of actually generated sulfur, which was totally unexpected. So here's another example of us all trying to do our best and still, I won't say failing miserably, but anyway. Let's move on. Can't I move on? Oh, it wants to tell you all kinds of exciting things. Okay. We've been talking about this for quite a while, the idea of trying to work with colleagues in other fields and figure out how we can use information that exists out there in other areas, much larger than our own, to try to piggyback onto them to help us develop better materials for museums. Sandro Gopian is really interested in developing museum-qualified standards for materials in the way that you have space-qualified standards for materials for NASA. And he has been working with the Jet Propulsion Laboratory my colleague Meg Abraham, who many of you may know, who's been around conservation circles for years, is working with us as well to try and figure this out. We would really like to be able to develop some kind of standards. We already have some standards. We have ISO standards for a lot of paper-related materials and the PAT test. There are possibilities out there that can be used as a model. And I just had a conversation this morning with somebody about the fact, or several people, Smithsonian people, that we really need to kind of figure out how to get this moving forward, because I think it's possible. We're a strong industry and very small, and so nobody's going to do this for us just because we say it's important. I think we have to do this working with partners. And I I wanted to just reference Toby Raphael, who was referenced already. He suggested this kind of thing 20 years ago for the development of standards for National Park Service in particular, but exhibits, museum exhibits in general. And so he would be very happy to see us all gathered here today talking about this. So I just wanted to give a nod of the tip of the hat to Tony. So in conclusion, it's really not enough just for us to kind of write standards for, or specifications rather, for our manufacturers or for our wood shop that say, provide a clean environment, you know, use non-reactive materials. We have to become much more active in this process, all of us together. And I think the time is right, or getting there anyhow. We're all kind of floating around in this miasma, to use David's term. I think we got to get out of the miasma, and we have to really kind of try to move forward. We thought we got smart about this, you know, 20 years ago, but we're really just at the beginning. So I hope we can all say we're, you know, at a new moment of collaboration in which we can work with manufacturers, providers, and I was very happy to hear the MasterPack person say, you know, that they're interested in working with us. Clearly, our exhibit case manufacturers are committed to producing the best materials and the best environments that we possibly can, that they possibly can for us, and we can only achieve this by working it all together. So with that, I'll close, and I just want to thank my colleagues who were not co-authors of the paper, but from MFA Boston, from the Jet Propulsion Lab, from the ROM, and from the Museum of London. Thank you.
So I'd like now for the speakers for the afternoon session to come back up and sit on stage, and for you to bring up the lights in the room so we can all see each other. So, Tyrion, this is 5:15 or? Okay, and we have our same two people with microphones again, to pass around. And I will try to be better this time about getting people towards the back. I wasn't paying attention towards the back. And could the lights come up a little bit higher so I can see faces? That's good. Of course, now you'll know that I was lying when I said I couldn't, anyway, about names. I kind of forget names. So, questions for the speakers? Yes, Eric. Someone wanted, yeah.
Hi, I'm Eric Breitung from the Metropolitan Museum of Art. I have a question about the case design where you were developing the aluminum bonded wood cases. Can you talk about, or did you look at where, when they were leaky, which part of the case was most leaky? And I'm also curious to know, for that bonded wood, what were you using to make the connections between the pieces to seal them?
Does everybody have a good half hour for this?
Well, I'll say just quickly about the testing. We make, we make two different types of cases. One is the powder-coated steel for the exhibitions that go on the road. And I would say, in my experience, 95% of the time, a leak had to do with the manufacturer of the case just not being careful about how seams were made or caulking. And it's a pretty simple thing to find. We do a first pass gross test with a Freon detector that most of you probably have seen. You inject the case with Freon, and then you have this thing that makes a horrible squeak, and then you go, or we call it Mr. Squeaky, and it goes around the case, and it can show, it can literally tell you where a gross leak is. Quite frankly, the cases that we make in-house are the aluminum clad cases are, the production technique is so good, we don't use Mr. Squeaky on those cases. We go straight to the CO2 test. And generally speaking, for a new case, it has to do with the gasket and how the gasket was put in. For a retrofit case, it may have to do with how the bonnet or the vitrine pulls down onto the case. Does that answer your question?
We would typically, when we would do this sort of thing, we would actually try different configurations of screws along a seam to see how it pulls in. When we first started doing this technique, what we started out with was welding aluminum boxes. And that, of course, was not very cost effective. And it was actually William Rollins, a friend of mine, who had suggested that we try laminating the aluminum to wood. Once we got to that point, you know, I give William a lot of credit for that too. Once we got to that point, then we did a whole series of figuring out what the best joints were to get the aluminum to the aluminum. And now with CNC, we're even looking at carving out and making aluminum behind the aluminum. And a huge, huge part of that was each time we would try a different configuration on a case, we would test it. We would figure out how far we could put the screws apart before Mr. Squeaky would have his tantrums. Mr. Squeaky is not your friend, by the way.
So loud.
She doesn't call the carbon tester Mr. Leaky. You know, no. It would be Mr. Squeaky, Mr. Leaky. But the gasketing was suspect in many cases, too, because in order to protect the interior of the case from any of the wood products getting inside the case, you also have to, wherever there's glazing, you have to figure out a way to cover that. And we would use aluminum channel or aluminum stripping, or we would get that gasket close. With CNC, we can actually carve back the board to the aluminum and then fold the aluminum up. And in all these cases too, and I discussed it briefly with Pam, instead of using glue on these joints, we're using sand cure. We discovered it could be used like glue. It'll even thicken when you let it sit out, so.
Oh no. Pam is wrinkling her nose. But
well, we're not using it as a sealer. We're okay. Using it as a form of caulk in between the joints.
The sand cure. It was the product formerly known as Camger. It's a brand name. And there's, what is it, 901? I can't remember the, Pam's not speaking. But essentially, when you have an aluminum clad material, the part that you're most concerned about is a seam, because that's where you know, the vapors can come and the volatiles can come through into the case.
To get the aluminum on the board, you use the most hellacious chemicals known to mankind. But in theory, since you're building with that pointed in, it creates an effective vapor barrier. And we've had great success with it.
So what John did is he tested and tested until he came up with a joint design that has what he has dubbed a lake in it, which is just a reservoir of solid sand cure, so that if the vapor has to pass into the case, it has to pass through that lake, that little puddle of cured sand cure. And we built a little test box, and I've had Oddy coupons sitting in it for a few years, and so far so good.
I just have to say one thing about why I'm sitting here making faces. It was a long time ago now, but we couldn't find it. It was back in the bad old days, the Wild West of preventive conservation, when we thought that we could find a coating that would prevent wood from off-gassing. And so I can't remember how I got onto these guys at Camger, but I asked them to make a waterborne urethane that wouldn't be bad for humans and that would at least itself not cause anything, not off gas, anything harmful. And so basically it was without additives. And we never really thought it was a great vapor barrier, but it was sort of a vapor barrier. And somehow it took hold, and people still, you know, are talking about it, even though it's no longer the same thing. They've changed the formulation. The company name is different. It's caught on as being a good wood sealant, and if you use that on your wood inside exhibition cases, you're fine. And so that's why I'm making faces. I think this is a totally different use. So I'm not wrinkling my nose at you guys.
Well, I will say this. I will say this about that, and that's that we've tested the sand cure again, and it did pass. I also tried a 3-day, an immediate test. In other words, when you drill into these boards to put your hanging devices or installation mounts, you're actually creating a pathway. So I did a series of tests to figure out what could we use essentially wet in the case. And I thought, yeah, let's use sand cure. You know, this has been a material that's been bounced around for a while. And it failed, as you can imagine. And then I tried a series of caulks, and several of them did pass. So, because essentially what you want to do is make a plug for your mount if you perforate the interior shell in any way.
Yeah, and I wouldn't advocate it as a sealer, but we mm-hmm. have in some situations used it interior as a glue. We did a case in Restoring Earth which had an acrylic background, and we would cut the acrylic with spots for the air to flow through, but we used a sand cure then to adhere aluminum that was the same as the walls of the case, and it worked very well. The case is still 5 years going, so we're not using it as a sealer, which I think is a distinction.
And just to be clear, the museum buys the wood laminated now from a company, and we're not using sand cure in any way to bond the aluminum to the wood support below.
That's actually an interesting story, and I apologize for interrupting.
No, no, no.
We started out with manufacturers that would cold press aluminum to board, and we would use different types of board. The smoother boards worked better just because there was no translation of any of the wood grain through the aluminum, which would actually show up. But as we would get in boards, I got the unpleasant task of sending it back when the corners of it would peel up, because invariably it was very difficult to adhere. Aluminum doesn't like a lot of things. It likes air. Aluminum oxide's great, but everything else, it doesn't have great sandbox skills. So our manufacturers slowly, one by one, stopped wanting to do it. So when you seek a product like this, you either do have to do the lamination in-house, or you have to find a local who is willing to do the lamination. And the Weldwood contact cement techniques work really well if you're using two very generous layers and then pressuring it out for about a day. I haven't had any problems with that releasing.
There are a couple companies that were making it, but they were very narrow boards. So the best thing to do is to find a company that's still doing it.
We like that better because it's
you can control
a process
it.
That's difficult to deal with in-house. It gives off a lot of fume. It's difficult to do, and it's time consuming. Not so much as buying a high-end case, though. So.
The one thing I did want to add about testing materials is that I started thinking about how we handle objects in an exhibit to install them, and I started thinking about the gloves that we wear. And I started thinking about the fact that there was probably 25 different glove companies in the building, and I wondered if there was any one that might be better for us to use than the other. Have any of you Oddy tested gloves?
Yeah, we have.
Well, we Oddy tested 30, and every one of them failed. The only one that didn't fail was a special glove that is individually packaged and highly expensive. So I started to nose around and try to figure out.
I'm trying to think of the manufacturer. Sterling Nitrile. What is it?
There's only one company.
Kimberly Clark Sterling Nitrile passed ours, and that was the only one that we found.
I just tossed this up in the air. It turns out that there's a chloride that's used in the manufacturing process somewhere. And I have this information for anyone who's interested. But now we're doing touch tests. We're seeing how long does it get worse the longer you wear the glove? Like, is there any translation? So Dick is I only wanted to be him before lunch, you know, and so he has been running these tests, and we're now up to a 10-minute touch test through each one of these, you know, through each a selection of these gloves. So we'll have more to report later, hopefully.
Okay, getting a few more questions from the audience. Yes.
Hi, I'm Pat Loiko with the National Endowment for the Arts. For Richard and Pam, just three quick questions. Have you had to ramp up your gallery observations to look for new evidence of the events that you've been finding? Richard mentioned that some of the cases were opened more than others, and I'm wondering if you're, and because of the randomness of what you're seeing, if you're now tracking those cases to see if there's further events in the cases that have been opened more. And finally, it sounds like the air filtration system that Gopian is considering is still in a test phase, and you may not be able to answer this, but is there any idea how much added cost, you know, by percent, that might add to a case?
Well, we had a former NYU graduate student who was half-time doing her internship year in the science lab and half-time in the objects lab, first and only person we've ever had like that. And she took on the survey of the Gopian cases. So she went around, she started a database, she started an Excel spreadsheet, and we couldn't open all opening cases, a very complicated matter at the MFA, probably most places. So we couldn't go around and open cases when we felt like opening them. So she went around and looked at them visually just to see if she could see anything on objects inside the case, looking through the glass, recorded hazes, and when they could be open, we could look at the gaskets, but only when they can be open. So we haven't done that on all our Gopian cases yet. And then we're going back and observing ones where we've seen problems before, because they will get open. We switch objects in and out. Some cases aren't open for years. Some may be more open more often. Some cases, although they're supposed to be airtight, we didn't clean the gaskets sufficiently, and we know that they're not so airtight because there's little bits of metal and so forth on the gaskets. We now do more careful testing there. So some of our Gopian cases have been pretty leaky, so that could be a reason why problems haven't developed in them. But we really don't understand why we see problems in some instances and don't in others. It's obviously a lot of things going on with airflow, the amount of terostat exposed to the air inside the case, how well sealed the case is, not Gopian's fault in this instance, but maybe we have little bits of grit on the gaskets. We do open and shut them quite a bit, some of them, so there's opportunities for the nasty little molecule to go out in the gallery and be breathed in by people or taken out by our HVAC system. So we are doing a systematic survey, but it's not sort of a full press survey. We're doing it a little at a time, and a lot of it is visual observation from outside the case as far as tracking crystals. And as Pam mentioned, of course, white crystals, they're all over lots of things, and the causes of most of them have nothing to do whatsoever with the particular things that I discussed for the Gopian cases.
Many of the ones that we've opened are totally unrelated, and it's good for us to be aware of this, and everybody in the department has got a, you know, heightened awareness, and so people are coming up with crystals in cases all the time, and they often usually have nothing to do with this particular latest problem. But I also want to say, you know, and we've said this already, but we've been exposing these objects to all kinds of crazy volatile substances for many, many, many years. And as far as these go, this particular one seems much more benign than most. It's not that we're not worried or concerned about interactions with these objects, but, you know, they're interacting with each other all the time. And so one of the really wonderful things that I think that's happened is that, you know, Gopian has developed this really great filtration system. We haven't seen it in use yet. It's brand new, but I don't know the cost, and our colleagues are here, and I mean, they might be able to tell you, I don't know, but maybe you can approach them later. But it seems like a smart idea for so many reasons, because as the technology gets better, the cases get more tight, we have to open them less often. It's important to open them less often because we're you know, changing the relative humidity. We're broadening our relative humidity and temperature standards. We don't want to go in there. There's no dust in there. We don't have to clean. You know, there's going to be junk collecting inside those cases, no matter how clean. And interestingly, NASA doesn't really refer to no outgassing in any in their testing. They refer to low outgassing, and it's the particular standard that is important for them for total condensed collectible volatile materials and so forth. So,
have one question here in the corner. Sort of collecting anybody in the back rows have a question? Okay, you'll be next. So here.
Hi, Christina Sims from the National Air and Space Museum. I had a question about standards. So in developing ASTM standards, when you're going to purchase one, they can start at $45 to upwards of $125. And then also with ISO standard equipment, it can range anywhere from a few hundred dollars to a few thousand. So is this something that large institutions would partner with labs that had the opportunity to conduct that kind of research? And then establish like a database that would be accessible to all conservators online? Or would it be something that you would develop conservation specifications that could be posted that could be accessible to a small institution to implement themselves?
Congratulations, you've just joined the committee. yes and yes. I mean, most institutions do not have an unlimited budget for that kind of thing. And so our thinking has already been to try to partner with institutions that are already doing this kind of testing, because we can't afford to pay for those tests, let alone pay for the standards. And we probably can't, you know, do that level of testing ourselves. So the idea is to, rather than try to force the manufacturers to do this for us, because we're so small, they're not going to be forced to do anything for us, but to piggyback on the work or the requirements of larger industries like aerospace and see if we can't get them to comply. It's also very good press, and I think there's a kind of, you know, PR factor in all of this. I think partly, you know, large institutions like NASA are interested in working with us because it's interesting and fun for them, and there are so many areas in which our worlds are aligned, and so it's figuring out where that all is and making it happen as easily as possible for our field. That's not to say I don't think there's a lot of work to be done, but you know, I think we have a good place to start.
Thank you.
Okay, it's right in the center. Raise your hand. Yes.
Thanks. I'm Sharon Penton. I'm a freelance conservator, and I used to work at the British Museum. And it's not a question. It was just something I wanted to say about what I've experienced. And I know there was somebody from, is it MasterPack or something? Somebody was here earlier, and we're talking about talking to distributors and to manufacturers. And I found in the past that sometimes the manufacturers may approach conservators, and sometimes it can be quite a hard sell. I mean, trying to explain to them, well, this is the Oddy test, and I was personally involved in one instance where there was somebody who manufactured foam, and they wanted to do an in-house Oddy test, and can you teach me how to do an Oddy test, and then I can do it, and I can put it on our website, and we can do it ourselves, and we're saving the conservators' time and effort. And it was really hard to explain to this guy, who claimed to be a scientist, but I suspect he was more of a salesman, that, you know, it was very subjective, and he thought it was going to be a true or false, a very clear-cut scientific method. And he's like, you know, I've got all this money I can throw at it and all that. But so I think when these companies are approaching us, I think they need to consider that and not go in with these presumptions. From all the speakers here today, I mean, every museum is completely different, and So it's great to have standardizations and everything, but you know it's going to be difficult to come up with standards for our institutions because we are so different, and maybe you know like NASA and all the space agencies across the world, they're all you know same goal of sending stuff into space, but our spaces are each unique and different, and they have unique you know the different levels of pollution, how much budget we all have, and I think we really need to work at getting manufacturers and suppliers to come to your institution and see what you're dealing with and say, hey, you, if you want to work with us, this is where we work, this and see it, and so that they just have a better understanding of things. Don't know what you think about. But.
Okay, thanks. And then question here from Ed Light. And any other questions? Okay, I'll take this gentleman here next in the end. Yeah. And maybe one more after that. Or no, yeah. And then you next.
Okay, Ed Light, industrial hygienist with Building Dynamics. I had several quick questions on the optoelectronic nose. First of all, how is the sample collected? Is this like a passive dosimeter? And what would be a typical sampling time for the kind of detection limit you want?
It is a passive dosimeter, and I actually have one in my bag I can show you. sorry, what was the second?
Oh,
the amount of
what
time?
Kind of
it can be very quick.
Time?
It can be very, very quick. And they cost.
Talking like minutes?
They
hours?
Cost a dollar each.
Oh, that was my third question.
Oh.
Okay. Second question, can you use that to get an integrated measurement of air coercivity, or is it like...
What do you mean by integrative?
Well, I think you mentioned chemical specific and maybe pH. Can you maybe this hasn't been done, but is potential to get the overall coercivity of the combined corrosive agents in the air? Idea, maybe.
I don't think
at.
It's very generalized. But you get a tremendous amount of information at one go.
On specific VOCs.
Yes.
Okay.
Classes of VOCs
yes.
would
but
be
you
a better way to
you,
put it. Would
yeah.
be classes of VOCs.
Yes.
Aldehydes.
By class
acids,
or by specific?
Yes, not specific compound, a class of compounds.
Well, they
like
do.
Acids will be detected. Possibly that could be narrowed down further to types of acids.
They do.
Aldehydes can be detected, could be narrowed down. They can custom design these things to look for specific, fairly specific compounds because the colorimetric reactions, if you're measuring all these different colors and you have your database, they can come up with very specific identifications. So they can come up with modifications of this that could be used in revised kind of Oddy testing, you know, in a new, couldn't call it Oddy anymore, I guess. We'd have to call it the electronic nose testing or something.
Can you give us a...
We could put it in display cases as they did with the Disney cells in the China and that the GCI or that they loaned to China. They had the things inside the cases themselves or inside the crates that they were shipped in, the cases they were shipped in. There's many possibilities for the technology. It's new, but it can be quite specific, or it can be at least the class of compounds, like say aldehydes. Maybe you don't get more specific than that, but it's very specific to aldehydes.
So am I getting the impression this is under development, not really ready for prime time in terms of you know, specific standard and protocol?
He's writing another NSF grant, which I don't know when he has submitted it, which I am hopeful that he will get, and then we will develop. The MFA will be a test site for the further refinement of this specifically for use by the museum community.
Can you give us
okay,
a...
Okay, well, actually, I think I'm going to interrupt
just,
you. You've already had four.
Can you give us a reference for this or get it to us?
Yes. I mean,
we can publish that and put that into the abstracts. Yeah. And put it back online. We can do that. Yeah. Okay. Gentleman here in the center.
Hi, I'm Jamie Haskell. I'm a mount maker and preparator, formerly from the museums in New Mexico. In looking at you know, all the effort that's been put into excluding compounds, and obviously seeing that it's still pretty hard to do. And thinking about this, especially in terms of what we ran into in New Mexico, of having a very, very limited supplier base, and you know, it being very difficult and expensive to get things. I'm so glad to see Gopian working on a filtration system, and because it seemed that trying to sequester volatiles instead of eliminate them seems to be a more reasonable and possibly more sure way to go. And I've wondered about, you know, that being a very active system, could many of these things benefit from just the greater use of scavengers and pans of activated charcoal and things that are within the grasp of the small museum and the small shops and cost? And could you comment on that?
The man who can best answer that question is sitting right next to you, but may I introduce Oscar Chiantori? But let me just say that this material has only really been vetted by the University of Turin so far for TMP, although it seems to have a much broader capability than that.
If I can say something, we tested the material for this particular application, but it is, of course, it's a general activated carbon for family of basic compounds, and then you can have also the activated carbon for acidic compounds, and then they produce the different types and the normal activated carbons for gases, for normal pollutants. And you can put together the two or three, depending on your, and therefore you get a complete set, let's say, of purification. Of course, so this is interesting because you can. The interesting part is that are these small beads embedded in a polyurethane foam, so there is a high porosity, and therefore you can have a flow quite easily, and this is what we are tested, and we are testing, and we think that this is a way to go, and it's convenient, as you said, it's affordable, so that's the main thing.
Also, Corrosion Intercept makes their product in a foam form that is specifically for use in filters, and it has an incredibly high surface area in the same way.
Okay, a couple more questions from Eric in the back center, and then one more after Eric.
So on that related topic, again, Eric from Metropolitan Museum of Art, we're working really hard to filter out materials. I'm wondering if you've considered, since we know some material, we probably don't have enough buying capacity to get manufacturers to make exactly what we want, and we're starting to learn what volatile chemicals are coming out of, say, these foams or gaskets or what have you. Coming up with methods or considering modifying commercially available materials so that you eliminate the TMP that's there before you use it. So sticking it into a vacuum oven. This relates to the chart you put up that I think came from Turin, where they heated the material and then the concentration went down to closer to zero. This is a good demonstration of what I'm talking about, that if you can't afford a filtration system, maybe we can think about modifying commercially available materials before we use them to eliminate the things that aren't actually degradation products of those materials. Have you considered that?
We talked a lot about heating, and I mean, in the building trade, you know, the bakeout was a very hot topic years ago, and now it's fallen into disfavor, but the idea was that you would, you know, raise the temperature in a building to get all that junk off gas from everything in the building before it was occupied. And now there was thinking, I'm not really up on the subject right now, you know, as to the moment, but after that there was a period of time in which people thought that was a really lousy idea because it released or could release more material from this from construction and furnishing materials in that environment, but you can't really heat an adhesive like Terastat before you use it, because then it cures. So you could heat a case, you could off gas, you could raise the heat inside a case before you, you know, you'd have to build that time in. Ideally, you know, I mean, how?
But you could do that with a foam, for instance, or the gasket, right? I agree that a glue you wouldn't heat, but you know, there's some things where you can. I don't know, just curious if you're considering it, but it's interesting to hear they've thought about doing it on buildings before. I didn't know that.
Well, if you wanted to use Tenavin 770 and you're concerned about TMP, you could obviously heat the Tenavin 770 and get rid of the TMP free, really readily. Doesn't help us with the cases that have Terastat in it that has TMP in it. Our particular problem is figuring how to get rid of the residual TMP inside our hundreds of Gopion cases manufactured in this particular period of time. Terastat 9220 was used in them. They all contain the Tenavin that has the free TMP in some level. What can we do to get rid of the free TMP or to essentially reduce it to zero in cases that are already constructed without taking the cases apart? That's our very specific problem, which really only applies to these specific cases that have this particular Hinkle product in it that had this particular Tenavin in it. So I don't think many other people will see this particular problem, may never see it again, unless somebody chooses to use Terastat 9220.
Well, we don't know why that Tenavin in particular was chosen for that particular product or what other products it's in. Mm-hmm. I mean,
well, we know a lot of things that have Tenavin 770 in it, because it's like all the plastic wraps in many of our foods could have Tenavin 770 in it. That's one of its major selling points, is it's the only approved one for use in indirect contact with food. So I think 770 is probably in a lot of products at the moment. But there's no concern whatsoever by anybody about that low level. As near as I can tell, health effects, even though you might be ingesting a little of it, you're exposed to a little of it breathing, there's no particular concern because the levels are so extremely low. And if our cases were really leaky, we probably never would have known it's coming out of the Terastat 9220. But unfortunately, from this respect, they're not leaky. So the TMP could build up to the level in the display cases. And being a very reactive little amine, can react with acids around the cases. So it was a combination of circumstances. I don't want to say perfect storm, bad analogy probably, but that bad combination of circumstances, this combination of circumstances that created these little problems. And again, I don't think they're little problems. Unless you have Gopion cases manufactured in a certain period of time, you probably never will encounter this particular problem. It's just another case study of, that's bad. It's just another study of indicating that that in a closed environment, you have air building up. I thought of calling this sick display case syndrome, you know, as opposed to sick building syndrome. A lot of people have gotten sick in buildings once they started becoming very airtight and volatile compounds got out of rugs and everything else into the air that wasn't exchanged very often. You make people sick. You could make objects sick by doing the same thing in a display case. And we really have to figure out what's in the air in a display case, and that's a function of all the things many people have talked about already. Construction materials, the objects in the case, the treatments the objects in the case have undergone. There's an awful lot of information you need that most of us can't really gather because we don't have the equipment or the expertise or the time. We can't do all that work associated with everything that's inside a case, let alone measure the stuff that's floating around inside the case. We don't have that ability at the MFA at the moment. We could gear up and start doing that at the expense of other things that the science lab is supposed to be doing, like studying the works of art directly in the collection. It's complicated. And again, our problem, I think it's a pretty unique one. We have to figure out how to deal with it now. Gopion's really helping us, and the people at the University of Turin, and this filtration system that Oscar and his colleagues developed. This was specifically designed, it could be used for many purposes, but it was specifically designed to take TMP out of the air inside Gopion cases that had Terastat 9220 in it. That was the impetus for developing that particular system and that particular filtration product. As Oscar mentioned, there's lots of filtration products. Some work for some compounds, some for others. He had to work hard to find this new Purifil product that worked with TMP. because some of the other filtration materials, charcoal, TMP doesn't like them, isn't collected by them, weren't effective. So when you talk about filtration, you have to kind of know what compounds you want to remove to start with, because your filtration material is not going to remove everything, your one filtration material.